Two Words Publishing presents Scripture Alone, Exploring the Bible's Accuracy, Authority, and Authenticity. Written by James R. White. Narrated by Claton Butcher. This book is dedicated to my son, Joshua Daniel White. I have often said God knew I would never pursue the ministry He has entrusted to me without giving me the best children He had available, and so He did. My son is a great source of joy and fulfillment, and I openly and gladly tell any who wish to hear that I could never pursue this work without the support of my wife, my son, and my daughter. The defender of the faith in these pages is named Joshua in honor of my son and of my having had the tremendous privilege of baptizing him at the Phoenix Reformed Baptist Church, where I am an elder. Thank you, Joshua, my son, and also my brother in Christ. Introduction. Every author thinks his or her book is truly needed at his or her time in church history. At least, I like to think so. I would hate to think anyone writes books just for the sake of writing books. I certainly do not. Every editor with whom I've ever worked will testify that I often comment on having no intention to reinvent the wheel. I have not written a book specifically on Jehovah's Witnesses, for example, simply because there are a number of very good works already in print on the subject, written by solid authors and containing solid information. Why should I repeat what someone else has already done? However, the book you're listening to, if God has blessed my efforts in writing it, is unlike any other book currently available. Sure, every book is unique, but I mean this in a particular sense. And yes, any book I write will be unique because of my background, which includes more than 4 dozen moderated public debates against leading apologists of prominent religious beliefs, almost all of whom are united in denying the sufficiency of the Bible to function as the church's sole, infallible rule of faith. Seminary teaching experience in the biblical languages, apologetics and theology, and the office of elder in a local Christ-professing, Bible-believing church. Scripture alone should be specifically unique because of what I am seeking to do and because of the impact I want it to have upon you, the listener. First, I am not seeking to write a massive scholarly tome on sola scriptura. That has already been done more than once, and tremendous works defending this truth are already in print. This book should be considered a primer, an introduction to those much longer works. In general, the great works of past believers are not written in a popular style. They spoke more clearly to past generations. One must want to work through them to arrive at the goal, and it is my intention to compel my fellow believers to want to do that work. Second, I write as a pastor, theologian, apologist who believes firmly that man is a singular whole. You cannot divide man's mind from his heart, his soul. I am passionate about theology, passionate about the faith. I honestly do not understand how anyone can say, "I believe the Bible is the Word of God," without being passionate about that confession. I love the Trinity, justification by faith, the resurrection, and sola scriptura. I do not pretend to be dispassionate about these things, and as such, I stand firmly on this assertion: Christian scholarship that lacks passion about the truth is not worthy of the name Christian to begin with. If dispassion and detachment are necessary attributes of scholarship, then I do not seek the appellation. I cannot comprehend dry faith, arid confession, or mere mental assent. A person who has only intellectual knowledge of the sufficiency of Scripture, but lacks a deep, abiding love of the Scriptures and an understanding of how their sufficiency is related to the gospel and to the assurance of salvation, is liable to be led astray by winsome words or the traditions of men. At the same time, a person who professes great zeal for the truth but does not honor the truth by growing in knowledge of it can be easily led astray. We need a balanced understanding of and love for the truth of sola scriptura. Divine truths command our undivided allegiance, and this love of divine truth is what I seek to encourage in your heart. On the Backs of Giants. I have always believed in sola scriptura, though the Latin phrase did not enter into my vocabulary until adulthood. When I first began responding to attacks made upon scripture by various religious groups, I did so out of instinctual respect for the Bible and a strong sense of loyalty to the Word. Even in my conservative Bible college, little was said about the doctrine. It was simply assumed. I was blissfully unaware of the tremendous effort that had been expended in the defense of Scripture's sufficiency by God's people in past generations. The Reformation, traditionally dated as beginning with the posting of Luther's 95 Theses on October 31, 1517, brought intense focus to the issue of scriptural sufficiency. Indeed, the formal principle of the Reformation was sola scriptura, for it was the assertion of biblical sufficiency over against tradition that allowed for the recovery of certain biblical doctrines, justification by grace through faith alone, the proper form and governance of the church, the individual priesthood of the believer, and much more. The preeminence of the Word can be seen in Luther's comment, "The Word comes first, and with the Word the Spirit breathes upon my heart so that I believe." Rome taught that because she was the custodian of sacred tradition, people needed her magisterial authority. Hence, Rome vehemently opposed and denied the idea of Scripture alone as the sole infallible rule of faith for the Church. Neither did Rome sit quietly in response to the Reformation, as the Catholic Counter-Reformation blossomed in the later decades of the 16th century. The chief ecclesiastical manifestation of this movement was the Council of Trent, 1546 to 1564, which began its work by issuing a declaration on the issue of the nature of Scripture itself, April 1546. The Council not only claimed authority to define the extent of the canon, but also sought to check unbridled spirits, that is, those who refused to acknowledge the ultimate authority of the papacy, decreeing, "No one relying on his own judgment shall, in matters of faith and morals pertaining to the edification of Christian doctrine, distorting the Holy Scriptures in accordance with his own conceptions, presume to interpret them contrary to that sense which Holy Mother Church, to whom it belongs to judge of their true sense and interpretation, has held and holds, or even contrary to the unanimous teaching of the Fathers, even though such interpretations should never at any time be published." Just how all-encompassing Rome's authority claims were, and are, can be perceived by listening to the words of a leading Counter-Reformation figure, the founder of the Jesuit order, the Society of Jesus, Ignatius Loyola. He taught his followers, "That we may be altogether of the same mind and in conformity with the Church herself, if she shall have defined anything to be black which to our eyes appears to be white, we ought in like manner to pronounce it black." This is supremacy of the Church over the Scriptures with a vengeance. Loyola sent out legions of like-minded men to take back for Mother Church what had once been hers. The battle was joined, and while Calvin and Luther had discussed the issue of scriptural sufficiency in their writings, it would be left to their heirs to continue the conflict with a Counter-Reformation. One of the first to provide a substantive response was Lutheran Martin Chemnitz, whose examination of the Council of Trent takes up 4 hardbound volumes in its current publication. Coming right on the heels of the Council, it was a timely response that still carries value. The 2 most useful works from the era following the Reformation were penned by William Whittaker and Francis Turretin. Whittaker's Disputation on Holy Scripture Against the Papists first appeared in 1588, recently republished, but only briefly in print. This work is still available in major libraries and is well worth the effort to obtain and read. Likewise, Turretin's Institutes of Eclectic Theology has been recently republished and is valuable not only for its defense of biblical sufficiency, but also for its wide-ranging scope and depth of learning. Even so, disputes arise with each generation, and the great Tractarian movement, or Oxford movement, in 19th century England called forth one of the greatest defenses of biblical sufficiency ever penned. William Good's Divine Rule of Faith and Practice first emerged in 1842, then was expanded and published in three volumes in 1853. Good's work broke ground in providing a more modern response to those who had developed new arguments designed to subjugate Scripture to an external authority. As has always seemed to be the case with the enemies of sola scriptura, the primary response was silence, the "if we ignore it, it may go away" style of apologetic. And in some ways, this has worked, as the vast majority of believers today have never heard of Whitaker or Good. A few decades later, another important, though less in-depth, work was released, George Salmon's The Infallibility of the Church. Finally, the most recent turn of the century brought one of the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.